Thrive living in danger, right? problem is that he takes too much for granted and thinks he can handle everything until he starts to unravel. I went, oh, that's an interesting thing for me to try to bring up.
That's what they said.
You didn't do it.
No.
But we shot mine with the head that ended up, I think they used it in the mall somewhere else that they blew up. But I mean, you know, I think the feeling was that George W. was too depressing.
Too dark.
That they couldn't do that. I mean, it's interesting. I mean, in Get Out, Jordan Peele changed his ending too. The guy was supposed to die at the end, which was supposed to be logical that the cops would come and they'd see this guy, you know, in this white suburban neighborhood and everybody dead and they're going to shoot him, but, you know, I decided that would not be good. So, so I think that's what happened, is that there's hope and who knows what happened to them. I mean, I was driving the helicopter, so what are the odds?
Being in my own little box and protecting it all, everything, protecting all sides of my mind, anything coming my way. And I did that, and I started it before we arrived in Pittsburgh. I wanted to make sure that I had nothing to do with anybody except myself, and because I was responsible, would be responsible, just me. Because I didn't talk to anybody else, because I saw no other. You know, and I heard the little thing and all the stuff, and I said, kill those. And they didn't kill those, and the essence of the bomb. I said, oh, boy, it's okay. I'm not going to worry about it. Maybe you see, and then I said, you come down, and I shoot Willie, and all the guys, well, that you saw me point the guns at me. I'm not worried about myself. I'm trying to take care of myself.
Right.
Yeah, that's the point.
Including
David,
he's pointing guns at you.
David here.
Someone mentioned David today, and they said, David didn't shoot well. I said, did you see him run?
Question?
Any questions in the back, sir?
I want to say,
Jimmy.
Oh, yeah,
stop. Kim, what the thing about David?
David would be at the moment. He full well knew how to answer the question. It was ironic, I was in fact, I didn't know. So it was ironic that he became the one who could answer the question. Also, you know, your question originally, I don't think I fully understand. You said, did you have a lot of freedom?
Yeah.
Yeah, tons of freedom.
Okay, that door came in.
Tons of freedom in an act, absolutely. Yeah, you act on instinct and impulse.
We did a lot of that. We did a lot of that, God. It was, I think that we had a freedom and I don't know if the other actors felt that way, but there was kind of a connection of that we could, let's just go ahead and explore to see what happens. Or let's just do what we do and see if it works. And we didn't say it. I don't think we thought it. I think we just reacted, and it was the right tool, the right note. Everybody, as I said, I was astounded by the performances of my co-stars.
Yeah.
I really am.
Well,
yeah, so.
Taking them all.
You should give them a round of applause. Yeah. I hated his guts. He was a pain in the ass. I think I hit him one night. Come on, man.
I heard he's great, man.
Not just because he's George Romero, but because he is a decent human being, he is kind, he is respectful of everyone, no matter what your job is. You probably heard that about him, but it's absolutely true.
Yeah, I would say, and he was generous.
Yeah.
You know, it was funny, it's the guy who's making horror films was that, you know, he was the big bear of his behalf, because he was like that big teddy bear. But generous and kind and very thoughtful, you know, and you're talking about, you know, improvising. I mean, there were many times that I had an idea or, you know, and that George would never like do a strict directorial comment. He would never say, you know, take that and give the line, and he would never do that. But if he did like something, he sort of, there would be this slightest gesture, so you go, I think I better do it again, right? I better do it again. But he would never ever be negative, really. But he would get what he wanted, almost non-verbally. Pretty amazing.
I guess some. Good.
George would want to go around. I had never done a full feature before. And I heard him say NG sometimes. After takes. Now, I was being really naive. I was like, you know, this classic theater guy. Right? And I accepted over that 2 weeks. There was some high-tech film term. When I figured it out, he meant no good. You know, from the tape.
Yeah, they have the directors that you work with that create a certain atmosphere on the set. And some, for purposes of their own, are going to improve on their message of what they want to do with they'll create an antagonistic, they can be harsh, all for a purpose. I mean, Hitchcock was horrible for people. You know what I mean? I mean, they sometimes do that, but they have a purpose. They will bring something out. George was exactly what Galen said, you know, what Scott said. And that was basically who he was. So he always had a soft and genteel approach to his direction, to his command of the set. So he was always, you know, it was a pleasure to work with him. And it was almost as if you were working with someone that you were a friend or was a buddy, instead of someone who was in, you know, a position of power. You know, it was
crew, all of the crew was ready to do whatever George needed and more. And that's pretty incredible on a film set. And I would add, you know, when I worked with George on Peep Show too, there were actors there who were really, you know, had histories like Fritz Weaver and Harry Nye, E.G. Marshall, who worked with the best of them, and they were hesitant about working with George. They didn't know who he was, and they thought this is horror, and they, and all of them, every one of them, were so full of admiration and respect for George and the way he treated them as legends. I mean, E.G. Marshall was a legend, and they felt that they were able to perform in the film the way they wanted, and they were respected, and they adored.
This film is very strange. It has, I just noticed last time I was in Pittsburgh, I was there and Joe was a bit more rope and more. And the zombies.
Yeah.
They, you know, they're the zombies who have made a career out of this, film. You know, I mean, they've traveled everywhere. I mean, it was surprising. I was walking through, going to a photo op, and I'm walking through one of the storefronts that they use for it, and they had one of the zombies, some of whom I know. This one guy grabbed me and said, Ken, take a picture of me. And I said, oh, sure. He said, see, you knocked me out. And he had this big poster with shot of him and me. And you're getting punched by me. I read some advertisements. I come visit this shop in Monroeville or in Pennsylvania or Pittsburgh or something because JoJo is the zombie who did is appearing. You know, so they did almost. All of the people who were in this film, who were zombies or have big roles in it, they had a sense of stardom or celebrity because of this film. And some of them have traveled almost as much as I have in terms of going out and outside. I mean, there's the nurse zombie, the Christmas zombie, there's several people. The one in Night of the Living Dead, what's his name, Heisman, Bill Heisman, who was the zombie in the cemetery, he used to dress up in his cemetery suit with the gray, and he would appear at all the conventions, and he was, until he died, that's what he did, and a lot of them still do. I mean, it's a phenomenal,
Eugene.
It is a, I think, Dawn of the Dead happened at the right time. Moment in history. I think that at that point, the gore, the color, technicolor and the gore, and the time that happened, Walter Barrett, Cisco Ebert, Gene Shalit, Rex Reed, all those people gave thumbs up. It's that those are major reviews in the country. It stayed at number one, number two, and number three the first 3 weeks of close sales in Variety. This film exploded. Remember, do you guys remember, I was going to ask you guys. Do you remember?
Without a rating.
Remember when we went to that press conference on Fifth Avenue at that hotel? And there were 75 to 100 people there, and including Rex Reed and all those other guys. And we're sitting there saying, you know, so it just...
But I would also say that, you know, the reviewers like Rex Reed and Ebert, the critics loved it, and the audiences loved it, but it was still, and it was unrated.
Yeah.
So that meant that a lot of theaters couldn't show it, or it couldn't be advertised in certain ways. There was a time, I think, there were a few other films that came out unrated. But it was still a horror film. So it was marginalized. So I remember when, you know, we would go to agents and look for work and they go, well, what was your last job? And they would say, Dawn of the Dead. They go, yeah, but what film, what real film?
Yeah.
And it, you know, they that was a,
oh yeah, horror.
That was a horror film. Horror was still a very strange genre. So, yeah. and I would say, so it took quite a while for this to become the classic that we know, because at the time it wasn't. And for George, it was also interesting too, because when he wanted to break out of horror, when he did Night Riders, you know, and that was his dream film, you know, which was his vision of what the world should be in Camelot and in Paris, you know, was his first big film, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. He found it in Paris in a little off theater somewhere in LA. Yeah. So that was his dream film, you know, to do the vision of the world that he wanted. And he was incredibly disappointed that, you know, audience didn't go because they wanted George in horror again. So it was a time, it took a while for Dawn to become Dawn.
Right.
You know,
I lost friends. I had friends who were in my acting class. I had friends, my acting teacher. I had people come. We had a screening, remember, in New York, our first screening,
yeah,
where we went to that restaurant right afterwards. Okay. I went in there, a woman from the New York Times came and cornered me. I had a date with me and, you know, a few people sitting with me. And she said, from the New York Times, and I said, how does it feel killing children? Yes.
Oh, shit.
I had another friend who I knew. I said it's a movie. It's spelled fantasy. But I had another friend who said, you were in that movie. And others said that didn't speak to me at all after that. You understand? My acting teacher said, I don't think they'll be able to see your real acting ability in this film. You know? He was right. but still, most of our friends, it was not, as Galen said, it was not taken, it was kind of, as we said, 1968 was not living in bed. Nothing between that and Dawn. It really shocked the Americans. Like, and then this. And they still had a pushback. Oh, this belongs over here. Yeah. Said, this belongs somewhere else. And Cisco and Ebert and Robert Baird and Robert Tree said, we'll give it a thumbs up. You should go see it if you like this kind of film. We're not going to see it again. So, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You've been waiting patiently. So
yeah.
Go ahead, Rob.
You said that. How did they pitch it to you? Did they pitch it as a continuation of Night of the Living Dead to you as it was going?
No.
Not at all? Just another horror film?
No. But I knew Dwayne Jones and I were friends. We were in the same activist group in New York. I saw him twice a week, if not more. I saw him when the Night of the Living Dead came out. I saw his picture in the lobby. I'm passing the movie theater in the lobby car, and I ran to our place where we meet, and I said, Dwayne, you're in the movie. He said, shh. All over the damn city, man. And so I knew Dwayne, I knew about the film, I was a fan of the film. Maybe not only because of Dwayne, because I just was amazed that I could look at a film that was that low budget and still be captivated by it. And I mean, when they reached into that burning car, pulled out the gas and started eating, I said, this is way off the table for me. And that was the beginning. But I said, I stayed with it. I liked the ending. I was kind of hurt by the ending, but
yes.
I liked the ending. And I was kind of bummed. So I never heard anything from George or Richard. Even when we walked in the room for the audition and went to Richard's office, there was a poster for Night of the Living Dead and Eraserhead and all that stuff in there. I didn't pay that much attention to it. I didn't know any of them. Just to read an audition. So we never talked about it.
Wow.
I try to introduce the movie to kids now, and they roll their eyes at some of the, you know, technology and stuff, but they get into it. It's paced enough to them, and they absolutely love it, and people need to keep introducing it to the newer generation before it dies out.
Oh, it won't.
And they always ask, what happened to Peter and Fran? Where'd they go?
I wrote that. I have that in the script. I wrote that, but not mine. But you're right. It that's exactly. That's no. I said he said what happened to your our characters.
Oh.
I said I wrote a script about it. But you're absolutely right. It doesn't. It is passed on, and if they watch it, they enjoy it, no matter what the generation. I don't know why, but it works. It continues to work. I'd like to do one thing before we leave.
I want to take one more question.
No, I want to say the last thing before we get out of here.
I was just going to say, you know, New Zealand Modern Art in New York is having a whole summer. They decided to do all their films this summer on horror. Women in horror, black horror, and they're making a whole season for horror films. I mean, they're getting audiences and kids into that museum that never saw that museum before.
That's right.
How do they keep them in? Lock the doors. But the one film that they opened with the whole season was Dawn of the Dead in 3D. And there we were at MoMA, you know, this amazing theater, and sold out with, you know, young people there. And, you know, the thing is, okay, 3D, you know, stuff comes at you a few times, and even I jump, blood is coming at you here. But the, I think the humor, you know, the effects are no longer as sophisticated as the effects are now, and but the humor and the characters and what happens and the tension and the drama of closing the doors in the home, it all stays. It's all there. It's just different. But you get involved in the stories, and you have people were laughing with the zombies at the escalator and the pie fight, and you know, and even the biggest laugh is when. That was when I refused David's proposal.
We'll get you a question real quick.
Oh yeah, I was gonna ask you guys, I'm looking back on it, what was like at the weirdest store so you guys actually shot at in the mall?
The weirdest store?
Yeah. Or is it, oh, this is a really bizarre store to shoot kill zombies at or whatever.
Gee,
it was probably
one of the more active scenes is when we're in the car, you know, and we're dragging the zombie and we're shooting at him. It's first still in the car, in a mall. I think that was a little weird, you know. We have to be very careful with that car driving.
So, Dawn of the Dead, I honestly believe is one of the best zombie movie ever made. And in popular culture, I'm just curious, have you guys seen Shaun of the Dead? So to be influenced, Edgar Wright, Simon Pegg, who are huge stars, and they love you guys. And
they love George.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And George loves Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah.
I'm just curious.
Nine of my movie.
Of course I love it. Absolutely. Well, I know.
That was a real homage.
Funny story about that, though. My wife, Matt, and I started getting hot, and I asked her what her favorite movie was. It was Shaun of the Dead. Now we're married. But no, thank you guys very much.
Again, before we go, please. Give a hand to these two.
Yeah. Thanks for coming.